हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, दिस इज सुमन अहलावत एंड वेलकम टू माय यूट्यूब चैनल डिफेंस टू कैम एकेडमी। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द लास्ट यूनिट ऑफ क्लास 12 एंड द लास्ट यूनिट हैज 4 चैप्टर एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द फर्स्ट चैप्टर ऑफ लास्ट यूनिट, दैट इज चैप्टर नंबर 13 ऑफ क्लास 12 बायोलॉजी ऑर्गेनिजम्स एंड पॉपुलेशन। दिस चैप्टर इज very very simple, okay, you will not face any sort of problems in understanding the chapter. So let's start our today's chapter. So what we are going to study in this chapter, there are three main topics which we are going to study here. First is abiotic factors and adaptation. So first we are going to study here is about abiotic factors and adaptations. This will be the first topic, okay. Second chapter is going to be about population attributes and growth. Second topic is population attributes and growth, okay. And third topic is population interaction. Third topic is population interaction. So these are the three topics of this chapter, three main topics of this chapter which we are going to study now, okay. That is, we will study about abiotic factors and the adaptations made by organisms towards this abiotic factor. Then we will study about population attribute and population growth, and then we will study about the population interaction. So let's start our today's chapter. First of all, what is the meaning of ecology? We have to study the meaning of ecology. So ecology means interaction in between the organism and between the organisms and their environment. What is ecology? It is defined as interaction between different organisms, interaction between organisms and interactions between organisms and their environment, in which environment they are living in and their environment. So that is called as ecology. What is ecology? Sorry students, what is ecology? It is the interaction between various organisms, and plus it is also the interaction between the organisms and their environment. So that is called as ecology. So here ecology is concerned with 4 levels of biological organization. Ecology is concerned with 4 levels of biological organization. And what are these 4 levels? Group of organisms make population, then community, and then biome. First one is organism. From the population, community. Community. And from the community, biome. Okay. So what is ecology? It is the interaction between organisms and their environment. Okay. So ecology deals with the 4 levels of biological organization. Organism, population, community, and then the last one is biome. So what is population? It is a group of organisms. See, suppose in the whole world, all the human beings, they belong to the single species. But in each and every area, we have the different population. So population consists of species. So group of organisms of same species within a well-defined geographical area. First one is population. What is the meaning of population? Group of organisms of same species or same species and they are living in a well-defined geographical area. Living in a well-defined geographical area. Geographical area. Okay, they are living in a well-defined geographical area and they are competing with each other for similar resources. They are competing for similar resources. Obviously, if they are living in the same geographical area, they will compete for the similar resources. Okay, and potentially interbreeding. So this is the definition of population. For example, population of crows in Chandigarh. Okay. For example, population of crows in any place in Gwalior. So that is population. What is C? You know about organism. I am an organism. You are an organism. So we together combine and make population. What is population? It is a group of organisms of same species living in a well-defined geographical area. Then they are competing for the similar resources and they are potentially interbreeding. That is called as population. Next is community. What is the meaning of community? All the population of different species in a given area. Okay, so let me erase this. So, what is the meaning of community? All the population of different species in an area forms a community. So, students, if you like this video, press the bell icon and subscribe my channel and share my channel as much as possible. Okay? Okay. So, what is community? All the populations of different species in a given area. Second one is community. What is community? All the populations of different species. All the population of different species. All the population of different species in a given area. Given area is called community. Okay. All the population of different species in a given area is called a community. Okay. Then what is ecosystem? It is a community along with the abiotic factors. Okay. So what is the meaning of ecosystem? Ecosystem. Here ecosystem means community. Community plus abiotic factors is called as ecosystem. Okay. So what is the meaning here? The community means biotic factor. It can be also written as it is the combination of biotic plus abiotic factors. Combination of biotic and abiotic factors. Okay. Then biome. What is biome? A large distinct region with its characteristics vegetation. Okay. Fourth one is biome. What is biome? It is a large distinct region. Okay. With its characteristics vegetation. So biome is just a large region which has lots and lots of vegetation. For example, soil, okay, climate, rainfall, temperature, etc. Example will be soil, okay, climate, then rainfall, etc. So this is the biome. Okay. For example, these are, for example, desert itself is a biome, tundra biome, temperate forest. Okay. Example will be desert. Desert is a biome. Then tundra, temperate forest. So these are the examples of biome. So what is biome? Okay, so what we have studied till now, what is ecology? In ecology, it is the interaction between different organisms or the interaction between organisms and their environment. Here it deals with the four levels of organization: biological organization, organism, then population. Population means group of organisms of same species living in a well-defined area, competing for the similar resources and potentially interbreeding. Then community, all the populations of different species in an area. Then ecosystem. Ecosystem means it includes community plus abiotic factor. So community is a biotic factor, so we can also say that ecosystem consists of biotic and abiotic factors. Then what is biome? A large distinct region with its characteristic vegetation. Okay, it will have its different amount of soil. Okay, different biome has different climate. Different biome has different amount of rainfall. For example, desert is a biome, tundra is a biome, and temperate forest is also a biome, etc. Okay, now last one is biosphere. We will study about biosphere. What is the meaning of biosphere? It is a part of Earth where life exists. Okay, so biosphere is the part of the Earth. Part of the Earth where life exists. It is a part of the Earth where life exists. Okay, it is the sum of all ecosystems. It is the sum of all ecosystem plus biomes. Am I clear? So we have studied the various levels of biological organization. For example, organism, then population, then community, then ecosystem, then biome, and then biosphere. Okay, what we have studied: organism, population, community, then ecosystem, biome, and biosphere. Biosphere is the part of the Earth where life exists. So it is the sum total of all ecosystem and biomes. Okay. Now, what are the major biomes found in India? Or what are the major biomes present in the world? Okay. So now we are going to study about a graph which tells us that what are the different types of biomes present in the world. Okay. So I hope this is very clear to you. So once again, I am telling you, ecology deals with the various levels of biological organization. For example, the lowest level is of organism. Then organism forms community. Then community forms ecosystem. Ecosystem forms biome, and then biosphere. Now, what are the major biomes present in the world? What are the major biomes present in the world that we are going to study now? So we have to make a graph here. Then this is a graph. Suppose this is the graph. Okay. Here this is x-axis and this is y-axis. Okay. On x-axis, what we will write? We will write mean annual rainfall. We will write mean annual rainfall. Mean annual rainfall in centimeter. And here we will write the temperature. So what are the different biomes? For example, this one. I am drawing here. This is one biome. Then this is another biome. Okay. Let me use another marker. Then here we have one more biome. Here we will have one more biome like this. Okay. And then here we will have another biome. Okay. So another biome like this. Here we will have another biome like this. So it is one more biome here. Okay. And then one biome is present here also. Like this. Okay. And one biome is present here. Here. So this is the diagram which is given in your NCERT book and very, very important for your exams also. Okay. So this is desert. This is desert. This is the desert biome. Okay. This biome, it is green land. It is green land biome. Okay. Then this is the tropical forest. This one is the tropical forest biome. Then this red one is the temperate forest. This red one is the temperate forest biome. Okay. Then this is the coniferous forest. This is the coniferous forest. And this biome is Arctic and Alpine tundra. Arctic and Alpine tundra. Arctic and Alpine tundra. So these are the various biomes which we have to learn. These are the various biomes here. Desert is there. Greenland is there. Desert and Greenland. Okay. Desert and then Greenland. Then here we have these two are the forests. This one and this one. These three are the forests. See what you have to learn. The first one is desert. Another one is Greenland. And these three. This one and this one. These are the forests. This is the temperate forest. Then after temperate, tropical forest. This is the coniferous forest. And this one is the Arctic and Alpine tundra. So first one is the desert. Nearby desert, Greenland is there. Then we will have the three types of forest. First one is the temperate forest. Then tropical forest. And then coniferous forest. And last one is the Arctic and Alpine tundra. Okay. So what I told you, what are the major biomes? Desert, Greenland, tropical forest, temperate forest, coniferous forest, Alpine and Arctic tundra. Okay, so these are the six biomes which we have to study here. These are the biomes. Okay, so learn the diagram. In your board exams, they can give the paragraph and can tell you to mark the different biomes. So desert, then Greenland, then desert, Greenland, then temperate forest, tropical forest, coniferous forest. Then Arctic and Alpine tundra. Okay, so these are the major biomes. On x-axis, you have to take the mean annual rainfall and here you have to take the temperature. So what are the major biomes in India? Tropical. Here I will write the major biomes. Major biomes in India. What are the major biomes in India? These are the biomes present all around the world. But what are the major biomes in India only? We have the tropical rainforest. Okay, we have deciduous forest. We will have tropical rainforest. We will have tropical rainforest. Then we will have deciduous forest. Then we will have desert. We will have desert also, and then we will have sea coast. Okay, so these are the major biomes in India. So if I talk about world, desert is there, Greenland is there, tropical forest, temperate forest, coniferous forest, Arctic and Alpine tundra. What are the major biomes in India only? Tropical rainforest, deciduous forest, desert and sea coast. These are the major biomes in India. Okay. Now, what are the major abiotic factors? Now we are going to study about abiotic factor. So what are the major abiotic factor which we are going to study now? Let me erase this. Okay. So this diagram is very, very important. Guys, if you want to take the screenshot, you can take the screenshot also. Okay. So let's proceed with the next topic. What are the abiotic factors? So we are going to study about abiotic factors now. Major abiotic factors. What are the major abiotic factors here? We are going to study about temperature, water, then light and soil. Here we are going to study about temperature, water, light and soil. Temperature is the first most important factor, abiotic factor. Water is the second most important abiotic factor. And then light and soil. Okay, so these are the major abiotic factor which we are going to study now. So first of all, temperature. If I talk about temperature, first one is temperature. So temperature decreases progressively. One moves from equator towards pole or from plains to high altitude. Temperature decreases from equator to poles, and also it decreases from plains to high altitudes. Plains to high altitudes, okay. So, in thermal springs, if I talk about thermal springs and deep sea hydrothermal vent, temperature exceeds, if I talk about thermal springs. Next is, if I talk about thermal springs and deep sea hydrothermal vents. So here temperature can exceed 100 degrees Celsius. Here the temperature can exceed 100 degrees Celsius. Okay. Now temperature also affects the enzymatic activity. Enzymatic activity of living organisms, because we know very well that enzymes will not function at high temperature. Okay. So based on temperature, we have two groups of organisms. First one is urethermal. What are the urethermal organisms? These organisms can tolerate wide range of temperature. These organisms can tolerate a wide range of temperature. Okay. Example will be birds and mammals. Okay. Second one is stenothermal. They tolerate a narrow range of temperature. Okay. Organisms can tolerate a narrow range of temperature. So these organisms are called as stenothermal. Example, invertebrates, fish, amphibians, reptiles. Example will be invertebrates. Okay. Then fish. Then amphibians. And reptiles. Okay. So based on temperature, we have two groups of organisms, urethermal and stenothermal. So what we study in temperature? Temperature decreases progressively from equator to poles and from plains to high altitudes. Okay. But in thermal springs and deep sea hydrothermal vent, temperature can exceed 100 degrees Celsius. Okay. So temperature also affects the enzymatic activity of living organisms. Based on temperature, we have two groups of organisms, urethermal which can tolerate a wide range of temperature, example birds and mammals. Xenothermal, which tolerate a narrow range of temperature, example invertebrates, fish, amphibians, reptiles, etc. So this is all about temperature, and now we are going to study about water. The second abiotic factor is water. So now we are going to study about water. Temperature is over now. So our second abiotic factor is water. Second most important abiotic factor. So what is the importance of water? You know, you have studied in the chapter evolution that life originated first time in water only. Okay. So life originated in water only. Okay. And aquatic organisms also face water related issues. Like, see, if I talk about aquatic organisms, they also face water related issues. For example, chemical composition, for example pH, they face the issues like chemical composition. They face the issues like the pH of water. They face the issues like the salinity of water. Okay. So, aquatic organisms which are living in water, they also face some issues related to water. Like, what is the chemical composition of water? What is the pH of water? Or what is the salinity of water? For example, if I talk about fresh water, fresh water has the amount of salt as 5 ppt. 5 ppt, parts per thousand. And if I talk about marine water, it has the salt content of about 30 to 35 ppt. Okay, so if an organism moves from fresh water to marine water, listen here, if an organism moves from fresh water to marine water, what the organism will do? The organism will do the exosmosis. Okay, it will lose the water. Okay, because marine water is the hypertonic solution. Marine water means hypertonic solution. As a result, the body of the organism, which was living in fresh water, but now it has migrated to marine water, it will start losing the water. That is called as exosmosis. And if any organism moves from marine water to fresh water means hypertonic solution, so they will show endosmosis. They will gain water. Okay, so aquatic organisms also face some water related issues. Salinity in inland water, if I talk about inland water, the salinity of inland water is less than 5 ppt. If I talk about inland water, what is the salinity of inland water? It is less than 5 ppt. It is less than 5 ppt, parts per thousand. And if I talk about sea, in sea it is 30 to 35 ppt. Okay. And in hyper saline lagoons, it is greater than 100 ppt. In hyper saline lagoons, hyper saline lagoons, it is greater than 100 ppt. Greater than 100 ppt. Am I clear? Okay. So this is all about water. So what we studied here, the life first originated in water. Okay. Aquatic organisms also face the water related issues like chemical composition, pH, salinity. Okay. Whenever and fresh water has salinity of 5 ppt and marine water has salinity of 30 ppt. So whenever an organism moves from fresh water to marine water, they will lose water. They will do exosmosis. And when an organism moves from sea to fresh water, they will show endosmosis, they will gain water. Okay. So if I talk about inland water, salinity is less than 5 ppt. If I talk about sea, salinity is 30 to 35 ppt. But in hypersaline lagoons, it is greater than 100 ppt. Am I clear? So this is the second abiotic factor. Third abiotic factor which we are going to study is light. The third abiotic factor is light. Now we are going to study about light. Okay. So here, photosynthesis requires light. We all know very well that for doing the process of photosynthesis, we require light, obviously. So light is also required for the process of photoperiodism. For photosynthesis and for photoperiodism we required light. On the basis of photoperiodism, we have three types of plant. One is long day plant. Another one is short day plant. And another one is day neutral plant. Long day plant, short day plant and day neutral plant. Okay. So these plants, they will flower only when they are exposed to light. A longer period of time. These plants will flower when they are exposed to shorter period of light. And in these plants, they do not show any effect of light. Okay, they will flower whether in high exposure of light or in low exposure of light. Okay, so in animals, light decides diurnal and seasonal rhythms. If I talk about animals, light decides diurnal and seasonal rhythms. Okay, what is the meaning of diurnal here? Means daily. What are the changes occur in an organism at a daily rate? Okay, every day. And seasonal means during a certain season or a special season. Then light is also a cue for their mating. Light also provides a cue for their mating, for mating purpose. Okay, then foraging, okay, and migration, etc. Foraging means searching of food. Okay, so sun's light does not reach deep oceans. We know very well that in deep inside the oceans, sunlight cannot reach there. So red algae are found in deepest water. If I talk about sunlight cannot reach in deep oceans. Okay, and if I talk about red algae grows or found in deepest water or deep inside the ocean. Okay, so this is all about light, which we have studied, the third important abiotic factor. So light helps in photosynthesis. Light also helps in photoperiodism. According to photoperiodism, we have three types of plants: long day plants, short day plants and day neutral plants. Long day plants will flower when they are exposed to long exposure to light, when they will get long exposure of light. Short day plant will flower when they get short exposure of light. And day neutral plants, they will not show any effect of light. Animals also, light decides the diurnal, means daily, and seasonal rhythms. What are the changes occur in organisms at daily rate or in special season? Light also helps in mating, foraging, for searching of food, and for migration. And sunlight cannot reach deep inside the ocean, we know very well. And red algae grows in deep water, deepest water. So this is the third abiotic factor which we have covered. And our last abiotic factor is soil. Now we are going to study about soil. Fourth abiotic factor is soil. Okay, so here nature of soil depends upon climate, the weathering process. Okay, nature of life, nature of soil depends upon the climate, weathering process. Okay, weathering process, whether soil is transported or sedimentary. Whether soil is transported, it is transported or it is sedimentary. It is transported or it is sedimentary. Okay, and how soil development occurred? How soil development occurred? Okay, so these are the various factors which decide the quality of soil. Okay, the quality of soil depends upon the climate, the process of weathering. Okay, whether the soil is transported some other place or it is sedimentary, or how does the process of soil development occur. So the method of soil development, weathering process, whether the soil is transported or weathering, and the or sedimentary or climate and the climate. So these are the various factors which affect the quality of soil. So what are the various characters of soil? What are the various characters? What are the various characters of soil? What are the various characters here? Soil composition, aggregation. First one is soil composition. Soil composition. Second one is aggregation. Soil composition. Then aggregation, grain size. And third one is grain size. Okay, so these are the special characters of soil. So these characters determine the water holding capacity of soil. All these characters, they determine the water holding capacity of soil. Am I clear? So what are the various types of soil? Next topic is, what are the various types of soil? We know very well what are the different types of soil. We have sandy soil, silt soil, clay soil. We have sandy soil, then we have silt soil, we have clay soil also we have. Okay. And fourth one is loamy, of course, loamy soil. We will have loamy soil. Am I clear? And from sandy to loamy soil, particle size keep on decreasing. If I talk about sandy, silt, clay and loamy, the particle size decreases here. So these are the various types of soil. Okay, so what we studied here, soil, the quality of soil depends upon the climate, the process of weathering, whether the soil is transported from some other place or sedimentary, and how does the soil development occur. So these factors determine the nature of soil or the quality of soil. Okay, then what are the various characters of soil? Soil composition, then its aggregation and grain size. And these three factors determine the water holding capacity of soil. What are the various types of soil? We have sandy soil, silt soil, clay soil and loamy soil. And as you proceed from sandy to loamy, the soil particle size keeps on decreasing. Okay. So these are the various abiotic factors which we have studied. We have studied about temperature, then water, then light and then soil. Now, how do we show our reaction towards this abiotic factor? So how what is our response? Next topic is response to abiotic factors. Response to abiotic factors. How do we show the response to towards this abiotic factor. For that, we have to again plot a graph. Okay. Here, we will show the external level. And here, we will show the internal level. Like this. External level and internal level. So, we show three types of response here. One is regulator. One is called as regulator. One is the regulator. Okay, example birds and mammals. One is confirmers. Another one is confirmer. Like this. So, these are confirmers. Confirmers. Okay. And third one is the partial regulator. Third one is the partial regulator. Partial regulator. Am I clear? So these are the three types of responses to the abiotic factor. Regulator, we will not show any change. Whatever the change has occurred inside the body, the situation inside the body will remain same. For example, birds and mammals. Then confirmers, they will keep on changing the body temperature according to the temperature outside the body. And then partial regulator. Okay. So now let's study. If I talk about regulator. So regulator maintains the internal environment of body irrespective of what is going on in external environment. Okay. So they maintain homeostasis. They maintain homeostasis. Homeostasis. Okay. So, they are homeotherms. They are basically called as homeotherms. Why they are homeotherms? Because the temperature inside the body will remain same whatever the temperature is present outside the body. Okay. But the temperature inside the body will remain same. That is, we show homeostasis. We are homeotherms. Okay. Homeostasis. Status, no. Homeostasis. Homeostasis. Okay. Example will be, what are the examples here? Example will be birds and mammals. Example will be birds and mammals. Okay. Then what else? Very few lower vertebrates. There are very few lower vertebrates and invertebrates are also regulator. Very few vertebrates and invertebrates. They are also regulators. Okay. Then physiological regulation. So how do we adjust our body temperature? Okay. We do the physiological regulation. We used to do the physiological regulation. We used to do the physiological regulation. Means here we are doing the sweating and shivering. In summer season, we used to do the sweating, and in winter season, we used to do the shivering. Okay, physiological regulation. Then behavioral regulation, migration. Behavioral regulation means migration. We will migrate from one place to another according to the situation. Then regulation is energetically very expensive. Whatever the regulation method we use, both these methods are very expensive. Expensive means our body spends lots and lots of energy in doing these processes. Okay. So, regulators, they maintain their internal body temperature irrespective of the external temperature. Okay. So, they are regulators. That's the maintenance of constant internal body temperature is called as homeostasis. And so the organism is called as homeotherm. We are warm-blooded organisms. For example, birds and mammals. So how? And very few vertebrates and invertebrates are also regulators. Okay. How do we maintain this regulation? By physiological regulation, means sweating, shivering, by behavioral regulation, example, migration. Whatever the method you use, either physiological or behavioral, both the methods are expensive, means our body spends lots and lots of energy in doing these methods. So, in stressful conditions, if stressful conditions are localized or remain for short duration, okay? So, let me erase this. So, these are the three types of response to the abiotic factor. Regulator, confirmer, and partial regulator. So, if stressful conditions are localized or remain for short duration, what will happen if stressful condition, what will happen if stressful conditions are localized? Stressful conditions are localized or if they are remain for short duration. If the stressful conditions are localized or they are remain for short duration, then how do we adapt to these conditions? Either by migration or by suspend. Either we will do either the migration or we will suspend ourselves. We will not do any activities unless and until these conditions exist. Okay. So migration example, Siberian crane. Migration example is Siberian crane. Siberian crane from Siberia. And suspend example like we used to do hibernation, we suspend all our activities, okay, unless and until these conditions persist, okay. So in stressful conditions or if these conditions, the stressful conditions are localized or if they persist for short duration, then we used to do the migration and or suspend, okay. So, Keoladu National Park, Siberian crane migrate from Siberia to Keoladu National Park, okay, Keoladu National Park in Bharatpur, Rajasthan. Okay, so this is the method. So we have studied about migration. Now we are going to study about suspend. What are the various methods of suspend? So here I will write the suspend. Suspend. What are the various methods of suspend? If I talk about bacteria, fungi, and lower plants. If I talk about bacteria, fungi, and lower plants like halophyta, bryophyta, they suspend themselves in the form of spores. Their spores will not germinate unless and until these conditions persist. Then if I talk about higher plants, so in higher plants, they will show the seed dormancy. The seed will not germinate under stressful conditions, okay. If I talk about animals, they suspend in two ways. One is hibernation. Another one is estivation. Hibernation and estivation. Hibernation means winter sleep, for example, bear. And estivation means summer sleep, okay, for example, snails. Hibernation means winter sleep, for example, bear. Estivation means summer sleep, for example, snails. Snails are the examples, okay. And diapause. If I talk about zooplankton, they will suspend in the form of diapause, okay. Diapause. Clear? So, in migration, animals move from one place to another unless and until the conditions in the previous place changes. Okay, for example, Siberian crane migrate from Siberia Keulado National Park in Bharatpur, Rajasthan. What are the various methods of suspend? Bacteria, fungi and lower plants, they suspend in the form of spores. Higher plants, they show seed dormancy. Animals, they show either hibernation or restivation. And zooplankton, diapause. Okay. So these are our various responses towards abiotic factor. Some of the organisms are regulator, some of the organisms are confirmer, and some of the organisms are partial regulator. So we are the confirmer, means we show homeostasis. We are homeotherms. We maintain our internal environment constant irrespective of the external environment. And if local conditions, if stressful conditions are localized or for a short period of time, then we will do two methods, migration or suspend. So next topic is adaptation. We are going to study about adaptations. We all know very well what is adaptation, okay? Any attribute which helps the organism to survive, any attribute which helps the organism to survive and reproduce better. Adaptation means any attribute which helps an organism, which helps an organism, which helps an organism to survive and to reproduce better are called as adaptations. Okay. So what are the various types of adaptations? Physiological, morphological and behavioral. First is physiological adaptation. Second adaptation. What is the second adaptation? It's morphological. Morphological adaptation. And third one is behavioral adaptation. Okay, so what is physiological adaptation? Let me tell you. So kangaroo rat in North American desert. Okay, physiological adaptation example is kangaroo rat. Okay, in North American desert, kangaroo rat in North American desert. So how this rat shows the adaptation so that it can live very easily in desert? It will do the internal fat oxidation to release water. First of all, it will do the internal fat oxidation. Internal fat oxidation to release water. This is the first thing. Okay. And then it produces concentrated urine. First one. Second one is it produces concentrated urine. It produces concentrated urine. Okay. Am I clear? So these are the various adaptation, physiological adaptation. Example, kangaroo rat in North American desert. This rat used to do internal oxidation of fat to release water, and plus it produces concentrated urine, and it comes out of its burrows only during a night time. Okay. And if I talk about desert plant, this is the adaptation of animals. If I talk about desert plants, what are the adaptations they have? They show camp cycle to preserve water. First of all, they show camp cycle. I hope you know very well what is camp cycle. They used to do camp cycle to preserve water. Okay. And what are the adaptations for high altitudes? Next one is adaptations for high altitudes. What are the adaptations for high altitudes? More RBC will start forming in the body, 8 million per millimeter cube. More RBC means 8 million per millimeter cube of RBC will be there in the blood. Okay. less binding capacity of hemoglobin with oxygen, less binding capacity of hemoglobin with oxygen, okay, and then higher breathing rate, higher breathing rate. So this is the adaptation, okay. So in physiological adaptation, if I talk about animal, for example kangaroo rat, it used to do internal fat oxidation to release water. It produces concentrated urine and it come out of its burrows during night time. Okay, and if I talk about desert plant, they show camp cycle. They will have sunken stomata. That will come in morphological. They will do camp cycle. In physiological adaptation, they will show camp cycle. And then if I talk about high altitude, more amount of RBCs will be formed in the body. And the hemoglobin will show less binding capacity for oxygen and higher breathing rate, okay. Now, if I talk about desert plant, so what are the adaptations in desert plant? In desert plant, they show thick cuticle, deep sunken stomata. Then deep sunken stomata. Okay. Then leaves reduced to spines. Okay. And then they show phylloclade, means stem thickened for photosynthesis, phylloclade. They will show phylloclade. Phylloclade means here stem thickens for the purpose of photosynthesis. Okay. And if I talk about animals, thick blubber in seals, desert plant. If I talk about animals, they will have thick blubber, means a thick, high amount of fat deposition. For example, seal is there. Okay. Mammals of colder region, they will have short ears and limbs. Okay. This is called as Allen's rule. Okay. So this is the morphological adaptation. If I talk about plants, they will have deep sunken stomata, they will have thick cuticle, and they will show phylloclade. Means here, the stem will get thick to perform the function of photosynthesis. Why? Because leaves are modified into spines here. If I talk about animals, the mammals of colder region, they will have short ear and limbs, so that they can reduce the heat loss. This is the Allen's rule. Okay, and they have thick blubber inside the skin, for example, steel. Next one is behavioral adaptation. Here, they will show changes in behavior, for example, hibernation, aspiration, migration, burrowing. Example is hibernation, winter sleep, okay, aspiration, they can show the migration or they can show the burrowing, etc. So these are the various behavioral adaptation. What is adaptation? Any attribute which can make an organism to live, to survive and to reproduce better. There are three types of adaptations: physiological adaptation, morphological and behavioral. In behavioral, examples are hibernation, aspiration, burrowing, migration. In morphological, if I talk about desert plants, they will have deep sunken stomata, they will have thick cuticle, leaves modified into spines and stems thicken to form to perform photosynthesis called phylloclade. Animals, they will have thick blubber and they will have small ears, short ears and limbs called Allen's wood. If I talk about physiological adaptations, in higher altitudes, our body will produce more amount of RBCs, less binding capacity of hemoglobin with oxygen and higher breathing rate. If I talk about plants, desert plant, they will show camp cycle. If I talk about animal example, kangaroo rat, it produces concentrated urine. It shows internal fat oxidation. Okay, so these are the various adaptations shown by the various organisms. Okay, so students, today we have studied about ecology. What are the various biological organizations of ecology? Then the abiotic factors and our response towards abiotic factors, and of course the adaptation, its types, and the various types of biomes in the world and in India. So that's all for today, students. I hope you like my today's lecture. If you like this lecture, press the bell icon, subscribe my channel and share the videos as much as possible. So that's all for today, students. Have a nice day to all. Thank you so much.